Good afternoon. My name is Charles Michaud, and I am the host of the George Washington Carver Society at WAEN-TV in Atlanta. You know, freedom is not free. The down payment was made by our elders, and we cannot default. Justice is not given. The elders sought it, were deprived of it, and still they fought on. Equality is not automatic. The struggle continues, and the gap is closing, and we will overcome. I want to take this opportunity to thank Mr. Fred Rushing for his vision of WAEN-TV here in Atlanta. And I'd also like to pay special acknowledgement and thank you to Miss Betty Craig, who without her help and support, this program would not be happening today. I really cannot say enough about how wonderful Betty Craig has been to me and how supportive she is of our entire community. My ambition this afternoon is quite simple. It is about voter registration. You know, our experience in America as Black Americans is unique. No other people, no other race of people, no other culture has the experience that we share. And I brought along a few pictures to remind you, and for those of you who don't know, to show you some of the struggles that we had to face in order to have equal rights and have the right to vote. And so I brought along some pictures of our history, which is unique in all of American history. When I look at these pictures and I think about some of our young people not wanting to vote, it brings tears to my eyes. The experience of Jim Crow, the experience of being thrown in jail because you just want the right to register and vote, the experience of having a dog sicked on you, ripping your pant leg to shreds, the experience of having a high-pressure water hose sprayed on you until you bounce on the ground like a rubber ball. The experience of being in Mississippi and being pulled over by the police, thrown in jail, and later shot and burned and thrown in a river because you were trying to register people to vote in Mississippi. That experience is unique. That experience is exclusive to Black Americans. And when I think of our experience at the forefront, at the heart of that experience, is Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Recently, I had a conversation with a woman who said to me, "You act as if Dr. King was some sort of god. He was a man. There were other people involved in the civil rights struggle. It wasn't just Dr. King." But I'm a historian. And I studied the civil rights movement. I studied Dr. King's life. And she kept talking, and I had to remind her that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., he went to jail over 30 times. And I said that to her, and she continued to talk. And I said, excuse me. I said, you didn't hear what I just said. I said, I'm going to repeat it for you, and I'm going to say it slow and loud so you hear me. I said, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. went to jail over 30 times so you could have full citizenship in America. No, he wasn't a god. He was a man. He was a black man. He was a father. He was a husband. He was a son. He was a friend. He was the Good Samaritan that Jesus talked about. And I myself, I read Dr. King's sermons. And he gives two sermons that I really love. And the name of both of those sermons is The Good Samaritan. And Dr. King tells the story of the Good Samaritan, and he says, if I don't stop to help this man, what will happen to him? When I was 8 years old, I remember one day I went outside to play. And once I got outside, I was walking down the street and I noticed an 8x10 picture that was laying on the curb. And so I walked over and I looked at the picture and I recognized the face on the picture, and I reached down and I picked the picture up, and I held it in my hand, and I remember I was looking into the eyes of this man named Dr. King. The picture that I had found was a picture of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. It was a black and white 8x10 glossy. And I held the picture in my hand. And there were particles of dirt on the face of the picture. And I took the picture. I took the picture and I slid it across my pant leg to wipe off the dirt. And I held the picture in my hand. And I looked into the eyes and I tried to find, who is this man? This man that had such a powerful influence on my mother and my father. I recall many evenings sitting in front of the television in my living room with my mother and my father, and Dr. King was on TV, and my mother and father were both silent. They seemed transfixed by what this man was saying. And so I took the picture in the house, and I gave it to my mother. And my mother held the picture in her hand. And she told me I could go outside to play. So I went outside. And after about an hour, I saw my mother. And she was dressed. She had on her Sunday attire. And she had her nice pocketbook. I said, Mother, where are you going? And my mother said, I'm going downtown. I need to get a picture frame for Dr. King. And my mother's still alive. And if you go into my mother's home, you will see that picture of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Several years pass, and I was an actor, and I was living in Miami, Florida. And one day I was on the beach, and I got a phone call from a friend of mine who was a producer. He produced off-Broadway plays, and he called me and asked me if I would be in his play. And the play was about the life of Dr. King. The play was called Road to the Mountaintop. And I was excited, and I said, yeah. I said, I love to be in the play. I said, do I get to play Dr. King? He said, no. He says, I'm gonna play Dr. King. And so he played Dr. King, and he told me that I was going to be Abernathy. And so I got a flight up to New York, and I began to study the play, and I began to look at the civil rights movement for the first time. I mean, really examine what this thing was all about. Who were the players? How deep was this experience? And I listened to many sermons. I looked at many photographs. And after about 4 weeks, I became tired. And I said to myself, my God, I said, how were they able to continue this struggle? How were they able to march on? How were they able to just keep going to jail? You know, the Montgomery bus boycott went on for 372 days, where black people came together and said, you know, we're not going to ride the bus if we can't be treated with respect and dignity. We paid our fare. And you want to take us to jail because of this law called Jim Crow. And I was amazed at the intestinal fortitude of these men and women who marched and went to jail and died so I could have the right today to vote, so I could have the right to go to the university of my choice, so I could walk into McDonald's and not have someone pour a bottle of ketchup on my head and I have to sit there and do nothing. And the last night of the play, this play was called Road to the Mountaintop. And the last night of the play, I was on the stage, and I was looking at my friend who was playing Dr. King, and I was playing Abernathy. And as I'm looking at my friend, I see Dr. King's face superimposed over my friend's face. And I'm standing on the stage and I see Dr. King's face. The spirit, it came to me, and I was standing there and it seemed like the whole theater just went silent. It was like a dream, and I was standing there and it seemed like the spirit said to me, you know my story. You know my story. What are you going to do? Are you the Good Samaritan? If you don't tell the people your history, who will? And God had equipped me to to be a speaker, to be an actor, giving me talent. And the question was, do you just want to go out to Hollywood and have a lot of money and walk down the red carpet for the Academy Awards while people are starving and hungry and there are wars going on, where people are not registered to vote? Are you the Good Samaritan? And I remember my body began to shake and tremble, and I couldn't control my emotions, and I began to cry. And I couldn't stop crying. And when the curtain came down, I went back to my dressing room, and I sat down, and my wife and my manager came in, and my wife looked at me and said, "What happened to you?" And I told my wife, I said, "I don't know." I said, "I don't know." But what I did realize was I no longer wanted to be an actor. You know, my life up until that point was a life of selfishness. Every time the phone rang, that phone call was my agent. It was for me. And I began to look at my community differently. You know, when I see a prostitute walking up and down the street, I don't see a stranger, I see my sister. When I saw someone who was affected on drugs, crack, heroin, I didn't see a stranger, I saw my brother. When I saw a homeless vet eating out of a garbage can, I didn't see a stranger, but I saw my father. One day I was walking down the street and I saw a man punch a woman in her face. And I saw my mother. And I went over to that man. I said, "Don't you ever hit her again." And Dr. King's life gave me a new vision for my own life. And Dr. King's life continues to inspire millions and millions of people. The song that was played before I began to speak is called In the Name of Love, and the artist, they are the most famous rock band in the world. And they named that song In the Name of Love in tribute to Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
So everything came out okay. You hear pretty good on the DVD. I didn't
listen to it. Dr. King.
So it's okay, the mic.
Changed the lives of millions and millions.
Okay. You rested okay last night.
And not just black people.
We'll get the lights later.
The yellow man. The brown man.
Oh, they are.
The Asian. The Hispanic. The Latino. The Arab.
No, baby. You on top of things.
Whoever comes to America, they have full citizenship because of what went on during the Civil Rights Movement. And at the heart of that movement, its very soul is Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. I remember reading a story about Dr. King, and he'd gone to see President Kennedy when President Kennedy was not yet the president, but he was Senator Kennedy. And Dr. King and Senator Kennedy had a meeting, and Dr. King was expressing the anguish of 22 million black people in America. And Senator Kennedy looked Dr. King in the eye and he said, "Dr. King," he said, "I need your help." He said, "I need you to get your people to register and vote." He said, "And once they register to vote," he said, "we can change the world. And this I promise." And Dr. King, he fought Jim Crow laws. He marched. He put on his boots. He wasn't a preacher who sat in the church every Sunday just talking. He put on his boots. And he went to jail 30 times. And he was stabbed and he was shot. He was hit with a rock. So we could vote. So we could enjoy the freedom of full citizenship in America. It disturbs me terribly when I think some of us, we would much rather pay money to go see a football game or a basketball game, and we won't walk to the library or we won't go to the motor vehicle and register and vote. I want to share a story with you. Because some people think that because we have a black president, that life is peachy keen, everything is great. It's not great. There's still racism in America. Trayvon Martin is a perfect example of what I'm talking about. Had Trayvon Martin been a white boy, he would not have been shot. Say it again. I said it. Had Trayvon Martin been a white boy, never would have been shot. No, we don't have Martin Luther King Jr. to go to jail for us 30 times. Johnny Cochran, the great attorney, he got a meeting with the owners of the NFL. And he said, you know, guys, we got a problem here. And the owners of the NFL looked at Johnny Cochran and they looked at each other. They said, what's the problem, Mr. Cochran? And Johnny Cochran said, well, he said, I don't see no black coaches in the NFL. That's the problem. And Johnny Cochran said, how would you like if I filed a class action lawsuit against you guys? Johnny Cochran said, I think you should try to find some black coaches for the NFL. Because if you don't, I will file a class action lawsuit against you and I will win. And so we have Johnny Cochran alone to thank for having black coaches in the NFL today. It was something that the NFL coaches did not want to do. Equality is not automatic. And I hope I hope you understand what I'm trying to say here. John F. Kennedy, great president, he often told the story of three young Irish boys that were making their way across the countryside. And when they came upon this orchard wall that prevented them from continuing on their journey, one of the boys, he took off his cap and he threw it over the wall. And then he looked at his two friends beside him. And he said, my mother bought me that cap. And I'm not going home without it. I need your help. I'm talking to you. See, I need your help. I need you to go get people to register and vote. I need you to vote. I need you to put your hands together. Give our community a lift. And so the boy, he told his two friends, he said, I'm not going home without my cap. That cap on the other side of this wall belongs to me. And I'm not going home without it. So he asked his friends, he said, put your hands together. And they put their hands together. And he said, give me a lift. And he put his foot into their hands and they lifted him up. And once he got to the top of the wall, he pulled himself up and then he reached his hand back down. He said, give me your hand. And he lifted his friends up on the top of the wall and they all climbed the wall together and they continued on their journey. And he picked up his hat and he went home with the hat that he said he was going to go home with because his mother had bought that hat. Voter registration, the right to vote. Out of all of the people in the United States, Black Americans should not be deficient in exercising their right to vote. I want to go back to the pictures again. I want you to see. I want you to feel what I'm talking about. This man just trying to register and vote so his children could have a better life. These young people are being sprayed with a high pressure water hose. These are citizens of America. The first man to die for the freedom of our nation, a Black man named Crispus Attucks from Barbados. And yet, his heirs, his grandsons and daughters don't have the right to vote because of the color of their skin. But they marched on and they went to jail. So you and I and our children could have full citizenship in this place we call America. You know, Dr. King's speech, I Have a Dream, is a very, very wonderful speech. It's very profound. And one verse of the speech really stands out with me. And Dr. King says, I have a check in my hand that's marked insufficient fund. Check is no good. Check was written from America. We never got the 40 acres and a mule. Our people built this country. We've never been compensated. And yet, some of us don't want to vote, don't care about voting, don't care about our history and our heritage, don't care that people died and bled and went to jail. Out of all of the people in this country, I mean out of all the people in this country, Black Americans have no excuse, none whatsoever, to not register and vote. And I go to the deepest place in my heart. And I say, if you know someone, if you know a senior, if you know a blind person, If you know of some young people who are not registered to vote, go talk to those people and encourage them and help them. I'm not asking you to stand in front of a German Shepherd dog and let somebody split your pant leg open. I'm not asking you to go to jail 30 times like Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. I said he went to jail 30 times. I'm not asking you to stand in front of a high-pressured water hose. You know, some people say, you know, I'm just one person. What can I do? One man can make a difference. One woman can make a difference. Martin Luther King Jr., last I checked, he was one man. Last I checked, Rosa Parks was just one woman who weighed about 94 pounds. She was one woman who started a revolution. One. The vote is a very powerful thing. When you exercise your right to vote, you have the power to stop another war. How we got into two wars is something I never will understand. But people just didn't exercise their right to vote. Because I don't believe anybody voted for two senseless wars. Freedom is not free. The down payment was made by our elders, and we, you and I, we cannot default. Justice is not given. Who is Trayvon Martin? Who is he? Is he somebody's son? I mean, do they just give justice, or do we have to go down and fight for justice like we did 50 years ago? George Zimmerman is walking the streets. Equality is not automatic. The struggle continues. Will there be justice for Trayvon Martin? I'm sure there will be, but there's a fight going on. We have to fight for justice. We have to fight for equality. Nobody gives us anything. All of the rights that we have marched, we have fought, we have died, and we continue to die. Our sons, if we don't educate our sons, if we don't encourage them to full citizenship, what is our future? What is our future if we don't grab our young people by the hand and lift them up? If we don't inspire them to take off their cap and throw it over the wall and say, I'm not going home without my cap. This is the cap I'm talking about. I'm not going home. I'm not going home without my cap. I pray every day. I ask God to guide me and help me in all of the things that I aspire to do. A young slave boy, he stood one day before the greatest ruler of his day. And God said to Moses, he said, what do you have in your hand? And Moses said, Lord, he said, I got a stick that I found out in the desert. And God said, okay, I'm going to use that stick. And Moses used a stick in his hand to divide the Red Seas. to march through a wilderness, to bring water out of rock and manna from heaven and lead his people to freedom land. He was one man. But God said, what do you have in your hand? What do you have? What's in your hand? What's in your hand, George Washington Carver? Who was so frail that he was traded for a broken down horse as a slave boy. And George Washington Carver, he sat in the science laboratory of Tuskegee and he said, I just get up each morning at 5 o'clock and I go out into the field and I pray. And I pray and I ask God to guide me. And then I bring back these little things and I work them over in my laboratory. And George Washington Carver did more to revolutionize the agricultural science of peanuts and of cotton and sweet potato than any other human being in the field of agricultural science. What's in your hand, brother? Pick up that pen. Find yourself a voter registration form. What's in your hand, sister? What's in your hand, 42-year-old seamstress from Montgomery, Alabama? Whew, Lord. I just got 10 cents in my hands. And I'm trying. Lord have mercy. I'm trying to ride the city bus, but the white folks, they won't let me. They told me I got to get up. But I paid my fare. But they won't let me sit down. I'm tired, y'all. And Rosa Parks, with just 10 cents in her hand, sparked one of the greatest civil rights battles this country's ever known. Just letting God use two nickels in her hand. She was one woman who weighed 94 pounds. What's in your hand? Pick up that pen. Find that voter registration form. What's in your hand, little hunchback, sitting in a Roman jail? I haven't got anything in my hand, bud. An old quill pen. And God said, write what I tell you to write. And Paul wrote, I have run my race with patience. I've finished my course. I've kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness. What's in your hand? What's in your hand, Martin Luther King Jr.? I've got a check in my hand, brother, from the federal government marked insufficient funds. My friends, the dream continues, and so does the lifting up of our young people. God has no other hands than our hands.